Good evening, friends. I welcome to all for 17th webinar of Corporate Professional, jointly organized with RRA Tax India, sharing knowledge and enlightening the corporate India and professionals. Friends, during COVID, these webinars are become regular part of sharing knowledge. On every Friday at 4 to 5:30, we are organizing program focusing on how to share knowledge and how to solve problems of corporate and professionals. We are grateful to all participants. They have joined this program in a large number, and continuously we are trying to improve our program on the basis of your suggestions. Today also we will do the same. This webinar we are organizing is very interesting but topical on deemed dividend and deemed income. It is a very confusing and sometimes so many gray areas. For that, to solve your problems and to enlighten you, we have invited very distinguished and elite panel for speaking, and they have agreed to speak on this topic, and they have taken time and shared their views. In today's program, we have two regulators and two practitioners, those who are doing day and night for this thing. First, I welcome Amit Mohan Govil. It is indeed my privilege to introduce Amit Mohan Govil. He belongs to 1990 batch IRS. He is a law graduate from Campus Law Center. He did his master's in business administration finance from Melbourne, Australia. Currently, he is working as a principal commissioner in income tax policy research unit, which is the tax body advising government on tax policy issues on both direct and indirect issues. He has widely ranging experience in tax administration, policy and legislation, and also an expert on telecom policy. During his career, he has held various positions such as Deputy Secretary, CBDT, OSD of MOS for Finance, Joint Commissioner, Directorate of Income Tax, International Taxation, Transfer Pricing, Commissioner Appeal in NWR, and Head of Legal Division of TRAI. I welcome Amit Mohan Govil for this program. Our second speaker is Ms. Neeta Singh. She belongs to 1993 batch of IRS. She is a law graduate from Campus Law Center and has done her master's in public administration from Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, Singapore, and Harvard Kennedy School. She is presently posted at Additional Director General in HRD Wing of Department. She has vast experience in tax administration and policy, and while on deputation, she worked in National Highway Authority, Ministry of Water Resources. She had also headed primary education in Delhi government, which got the present government claim that they have done a very good job. I welcome Ms. Neeta Singh for this program. Then our next speaker is Dr. Rajkumar Agrawal. He is one of the most qualified professional throughout rank holder. He is a FCA, FCS. He is a cost accountant. He is a PhD holder and he is a master's in commerce, law and management. He was awarded PhD in social responsibility in business. He is accomplished professional specializing in income tax survey, search and seizure cases, tax planning and strategy business planning of companies. He is regular contributor for article in leading journal and sought after speaker at industry and professional forum. And he regularly visiting faculty in various institutions. Amongst this, he held various positions. He was chairman of Northern India Regional Council of Company Secretaries, member accounting standard board, and expert advisory committee of ICAI. He has authored several books on repute on taxation. I welcome our Rajkumar Agrawal ji. Our next speaker, Dr. Rakesh Gupta. During this COVID period, he is, I think, daily giving lectures, and he has completed, I think this is a 59th lecture during this COVID period. Dr. Rakesh Gupta is also distinguished speaker, and he's a FCA, FCS. cost accountant, gold medalist in LLB, and did his master's in law and management. He was awarded PhD in corporate governance and ethics. After practicing a chartered accountant from 84 to 2000, he was appointed member of ITAT in the year 2000. After resigning from this, he resumed his practice as an advocate, appearing before Supreme Court and High Court. He represents UP government in Supreme Court of India as a special counsel. Dr. Gupta is a sought-after speaker at professional seminar and conference. He is a regular contributor of articles and has authored several books on repute on taxation. He participated in United Nations Committee of Experts on International Cooperation in Tax Matter, held in New York and Geneva in 2017, 18, and 19. He is also a member of International Association of Tax Judges and participated in the meeting held in Finland and Cambridge, UK. I welcome Gupta ji, and we will definitely get enlightened with your knowledge. Interestingly, today the 5 persons are there. Out of this 5 persons, 4 persons are from St. John's College. They are St. Johnian, except Meeta, all are for St. Johnian. And 3 are Campus Law Center, ex-CLC, Amit, myself, and Meeta Singh. So, and 2 persons are from Jubilee Hall. So that is an interesting point which I am sharing. So I welcome all of you. Now, friends, this topic of Section 56 is very interesting. I remember long back, one person came to me. He told me that I want to bring an issue in a company, and he suggested me that my company's valuation is 10,000. So I asked him that 10 rupees share is 9,990 rupees. What is the valuation? How you can do? So he told, aisa hota hai. Hum log Kolkata mein, we can do this. So this is one of the issue that 10 rupees shares at 9,990 rupees you are doing without any valuation, and then you are creating value and net worth, and then you are doing various type of manipulation. Then come to the loans and advance. People were taking loans and advance. This with this mind that I will not return this money, and they were taking money in this way. Then one time entry of capital, that you put money in a company and then there's no need to return. So these things created lots of issues, and that's why government brought out this particular section in, and continuously they are amending. No doubt the provision of this particular act is section is applicable for individual and company both. But as a corporate practitioner, when we do any corporate action and corporate transaction in any company, these provisions are must to understand, because these are the transactional breaker and they can frustrate the deal also. If you see the right issue, buyback, reduction of capital, takeover offer, amalgamation, convertible instrument, bonus issue, and transaction in a company share where the value is determined by the property. Now all these transactions required, the Section 56 is applicable. Right issue, 100 rupees market value, I can bring out as per SEBI formula, as per law, 40 rupees, 50 rupees, 30 rupees, whatever I want. But there was a case where the department had issued notice and they asked the tax on 60 rupees because you have issued shares at 40 rupees. And then the income tax tribunal has rejected that particular thing. And they gave that because you are giving to all shareholders and there is no change in shareholding. But the question is, if there is a change in shareholding and you are giving a right renunciation to somebody, then holding will change. It will be taxable. That is a one gray area. Second is that if you're doing the takeover offer, in the takeover offer, the 40 rupees is a price as per the SEBI formula. You have entered an SPA and then you are giving offer after 2-3 months because there's a procedure. And that time share price is going to 60 rupees, the income tax department will issue a notice and ask the dividend, ask the tax on 20 rupees. Now the income tax department is saying this is a rational decision of a shareholder, that at 40 rupees he is offering, though the market share is 60 rupees. But friends, 60 rupees share price has increased and the investor is giving because he is aware that my bulk transaction nobody will take, and the transaction at 60 rupees, even if it is taken at one share, it is happening. Then another issue is coming, last traded price they are calculating in the listed company. So in one of our case, the fair value of market of that particular shares was 25 paisa, but the last traded price last in the two three years back it was 17 rupees. So the 16.75 is the amount which the income tax will ask you as a deemed income. So these are some issues. Then come to the deemed dividend, where the you are doing transaction and this is a problem that loans and advance you are giving, and one company is giving loans and advance to another company, and that money has come, interest has come, but there's a taxability, and taxability is also 30% plus 15% surcharge and 12%. It is a very high amount. So these are the some issues which corporate planning, when we are doing, it has a problem. Now I will hand over to Amit Mohanji to start this. Amit and Amita Singh, both are from the department. My only point is that no doubt for entry abuse, this law has come to protect the revenue for this type of manipulation. But in the process, genuine transaction are also suffering. Today, you are giving loan to somebody, you receive back money, you receive back the entire amount, even then it's a taxable. That is not, I think, we require some thinking. And then various AB and company points here, which is prescribed what you should do. But we have seen that even if SEBI and company law is prescribing something, but income tax is asking some different way, it's a really problematic for transaction. The startup face problem, and they oppose for engine tax, right? The government brought out a new law. Now, all these things which I have raised, these are the issues which the corporates are facing, and when we are doing some transaction and advisory we are doing, we are facing this type of issue. Now over to Amit to say your point of view.
Thank you, Pawan. Thanks for a very charitable introduction. And I really welcome your initiative for interaction with stakeholders, taxpayers, to consider complex law provisions and have an understanding with both sides of view, that is within the tax department and from the professional side also. So as we all know, we are today going to discuss the concept of deemed income and deemed dividend. So this concept of deemed income has been there since time immemorial, in fact since the beginning of the Income Tax Act. If we see that on the concept of unsecured loans, Section 68, Section 69, unexplained money, unexplained bullion and unexplained jewelry, these concepts of deemed income have been there, and if unsecured credits are brought about in the books of our taxpayer and the explanation offered for bringing the money is not adequate, then those credits are taken as, are deemed to be income of the taxpayer. So this concept of deemed income has been there through the web of the Income Tax Act. We have the concept of deemed dividend. Deemed dividend, my colleague will be talking about. So there also you have where shareholders part with excess money to where the companies part with excess money to the shareholders, then the concept of deemed dividend kicks in. Then we've had the concept of notional income also, although the courts come down very heavily on the concept of notional income, but in terms of vacant property. So the concept of deeming of income comes in when you let out property also. And the biggest concept, biggest area where the concept of deeming provisions have come in, if we see, is the transfer pricing legislation. Now, transfer pricing also is based on internationally accepted rules that are there between nations. And when commerce grew and when a lot of companies started to come and started to do business in our country, we came about with the regulations of transfer pricing also. So in all these deeming provisions, what the intention of the revenue or of the department is that you want to align the value of the transaction with a market transaction. So in the concept of transfer pricing, we see that there is a concept of arm's length price. So arm's length price, basically transfer pricing deals with transactions between related parties. And when those related party transactions are not marked to market, or they are not as between independent persons, or they are not at arm's length, then this concept of deeming of income comes in, and the revenue can make adjustments to increase the value or mark the value of the transaction or the price of the transaction to an arm's length price, which is marked to the market. So similarly, today our topic of discussion is primarily of asset classes that are that were off market. So there is no issue when you have a full-fledged transaction relating to, say, immovable property or to or with co-listed shares or quoted shares or shares which are frequently traded on the market. Then you have a price discovery mechanism which is market-driven. And in transfer pricing also, we have this concept of where we can, suppose there's a price of trading in oil. So they are marked to the market in terms of what the market price is. Similarly, over a period of time, there were various committees, in fact, I have also been part of, there was a task force recently set up by the government to rewrite the income tax law. So I work in a policy unit called the Tax Policy Research Unit. And Tax Policy Research Unit was part of the task force, and we entered into very detailed the processes of rewriting of the income tax law, and the committee was kept meeting over a period of nearly 2 years. There were multiple meetings, long meetings, and all provisions of law were deliberated. And over there, the issues regarding where the correct tax is not coming to the department also comes up. There is representation from the side of the industry, from the side of the profession, and such transactions are examined. So now, specifically, when we come to concept of deemed income in section 43CA, where profits and gains from business and profession have to be determined with respect to sale of business assets like land and building, which are other than capital asset. So a provision was brought in by the Finance Act of 2013, where they said that the price that is discovered in a stamp duty valuation by a state authority will be taken as the price if the consideration received for the transfer of goods, for the transfer of land or building, was less than that determined by the stamp value duty authorities. Similarly, for capital gains purposes, when you sell a capital asset, being land and building, and the consideration is received, which is less than the stamp duty value, or the aggregate or the difference in value is more than rupees 50,000. 50,000 is a threshold that is kept for lower value transactions. Then that the value as determined by the stamp duty authority will be taken as the consideration for the sale of the transfer of that property for capital gains purposes. Similarly, in section 5610, provisions have been brought out where when there is a sale of immovable property or consideration is received, which consideration, and we all know that transactions relating to property and of late transactions related to unlisted unquoted shares or off market transactions, their value has to be determined. So mechanisms have been set up. The value of property has been tied to the stamp duty or determined or discovered by the state authorities, and also there are fair market value determination methodologies that are now being specified under Rule 11(11UA). So per basis, the representations that are received from the industry, from the stakeholders, and the stakeholders in this case is our professional agencies like that run by Pawan, Mr. Rakesh Gupta, Mr. Rajkumar Agarwal, and other stakeholders, plus what representations we receive, the government receives from the industry. There are modifications that are carried out. So therefore, this mark to market or mark to the state valuation authorities was brought about by the Finance Act of 2013 from assessment year 13-14. But there were representations received from the industry saying that the price that was being discovered and that is circle rates have now started going very high, and the real estate is going through a recession. So therefore, a safe harbor was brought about by the Finance Act of 2018, effective assessment year 18-19, where a safe harbor of 5% was introduced. That is, if the value was within the 5% range, then that value could be adopted as the fair market value. Then in the Finance Act of budget of 2020, the safe harbor on further representation by the industry has been increased to 10% in all property related valuations, be it under 43CA, be it under section 50C, or be it under section 56 subclause 10. Now the contentious issue that as per questions that have been framed by Pawan in his initial introduction, all these questions are mostly related to those of valuation under section 50CA, where the fair market value has to be determined on a basis as per procedure prescribed, and those procedures have been prescribed under Rule 11 and 11UA. So we will be dealing with specific problems. This is just I was giving you an overview as to why these deeming provisions are there, because the market conditions are changing, business, there are different products that are introduced, there are ways in which trading in the market is being done, and to capture the correct value, the government always keeps coming with amendments per basis. The feed-in to the government that comes is in the basis of judicial precedents, on the basis of decisions that come in, and where initially, as you would know, that when B.C. Srinivas Shetty, the cost of acquisition could not be determined, it had to be that no capital gains could be fixed. So therefore, the government has been designing law, the government has been notifying rules wherein they can determine the market value or mark to market value of an asset, let it be an immovable property or an unquoted unlisted share, because a listed share obviously derives its value from it being traded. But there are specific questions with respect to the trading, that there is infrequent trading or there is less trading, or and determining the market value of a share buyback or a bonus or a right issue. So these are certain issues that we will address. I think there are experts over here with us who will be addressing these specific issues, but we will deal with them in case there are any issues. So these are my introductory remarks. I pass on the baton back to Pawan to take this discussion forward.
Okay, thank you very much, Amit. Thank you very much for giving insight of the department's view. During the question answer session, we will further discuss this issue. Now, I'll request Ms. Meeta Singh to tell us about the D deemed dividend issue, what is department view, what is her take on this part? Over to you. Your voice is, please open your voice.
Yeah, okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, yes, okay.
Hello?
Okay. Yes, yes, okay.
All right. Okay, thank you, Pawan, for giving us this opportunity and bringing all of us together at this common platform where we can, without any issues, we can clearly discuss both the sides on the table can come together on one screen, you know. So thank you for that. And as earlier informed by you, I'm going to speak on deemed dividend. Which is section 222E as per the Income Tax Act. So the basically the whole concept of deemed dividend as we see has been embedded in this section 222E goes back to section 26AE also of the 1922 Act. The whole idea behind this concept, the deeming provisions, has always been kind of an anti, they are all anti-abuse provisions, wherein wherever, as very rightly pointed out by Amit sir also, that since everyone is in that evolving stage and the trade is evolving and things are changing and judiciary is giving various pronouncements. So basically, with the, in this changing scenario, sometimes we it is important that we come up with these deeming provisions. And as provided in the section in the Act, Income Tax Act, this deeming provision has been provided for dividends in section 222E. So basically, earlier the whole concept is the companies, especially the closely held companies who were trying to evade the concept, circumvent the taxes by not paying the dividends to the shareholders and trying to pass on that benefit as shares and loans. This whole concept of deeming provision came in to basically plug that loop. To begin with, as you all know, legally, if we go through the history of deemed dividend, earlier the companies were paying dividend tax under section 115O. As DDT at a particular rate which was prescribed by the government. At that time, the deemed dividend was not included under the DDT, and the shareholders were supposed to be paying tax on the dividends. So when deemed dividend came into being, the issue became that who is going to pay the tax? There are a lot of judicial pronouncements which were made, wherein the department went ahead and started taxing the individuals, some especially the companies which were where the loans and advances were being advanced, the recipients. And so there we have a plethora of cases which came up. And finally, I think in the case of Supreme Court has taken a call in the case of Aniket that it is the shareholder which is the final recipient in whose hands the tax has to be taxed. However, in the year 2018, as you all know, the DDT changed, the whole provisions changed, and again we went back, the deemed dividend got included in DDT, and there the tax, the percentage of tax was definitely higher, because as very rightly pointed out by the Supreme Court in many cases, that since they are deeming provisions, we have to very strictly monitor these cases, and therefore automatically the taxation rate was higher. And for a long time, the corporates have been chasing this cause that the companies are paying DDT besides the normal taxation which they pay. So there has been always a kind of a technical war between the taxpayers and the corporates and the department, and of course involving the judiciary into it. That are we actually leading to double taxation? So I think, as you all are know, as all are aware, then the coming assessment year 2021 onwards, the DDT has been withdrawn, and now we have gone full circle and gone back again to the old regime that the tax has to be calculated from the shareholder and not from the company. So this is the basic thing about the deemed dividend provisions. However, basically what we have to see is that there have been plethora of cases which have actually come up and kind of decided the law behind deemed dividend as to in what all are important. So basically, I feel under this section of 222E, it basically comprises of three important limbs. And there have been a lot of cases where we have differed. First of all is that what is an advance or a loan? What is the nature of the advance and loan which has been given to the shareholder? So there are again various issues that what exactly amounts to a loan or what exactly is an advance? And there are cases again which we can discuss. There are a number of cases. But very categorically, the provisions of the Act do not define what kind of a loan or what kind of an advance is actually included or excluded. So it is a loan and an advance. So whatever is a loan or an advance has to be included until and unless it is excluded because of certain facts which have come before the cases, before the judiciary. So we and then the provision very categorically again mentions what kind of voting rights the person should have, the substantial interest he should have in the different concern, and all those again have been part of the judicial pronouncements. And finally, we come back that it is not necessary that the beneficial owner has to be registered owner also. They say, no, it's not there. The last, the latest case which has come up has been decided by the Supreme Court in Gopal and Sons HUF. They have taken a call that it is not necessary that a beneficial owner has to be a registered owner also. So it is not that they both are linked together. So where earlier the courts had pronounced that no, if you are a beneficial owner, you have to be registered owner only, and then only deemed dividend provision is applicable to you. However, that has again been ruled out by the court in the latest judgment in 2016 that no, there is an explanation 3 which takes care of that. So therefore, you need not have, it is not very necessary that a beneficial owner has to also be a registered owner. So that decision has been taken. So this is how this deemed dividend concept has been evolving, because it is actually, I'm not the right person to say, but it is actually a very draconian act in this, draconian provision in the sense that, because sometimes people are not aware, you know, and they suddenly, they feel that, okay, I have a company running, I'm making my own profits, and I can't even give a loan to someone, or I can't even give a loan, or I can't even, advance money to someone, or wherever I need to advance money. So in that sense, if you see that it is really, really interpreted in a very strict manner by the Income Tax Department, over the years, we have been really, really monitoring it in a very strict manner. Then we arise another question, which arises: what is a payment to a concern? What is a concern? That also has been part of a lot of judicial pronouncement as to what concerns are included and what concerns are not included. Whether HUF is included, whether HUF's karta along with the concern, if he is more than 10% shareholder and a 20% beneficial substantive holder, whether that law will be applicable to them. So all these are very factual things which has to be taken care of as we go along. And therefore, I think the corporate world also need to be very aware with the judicial decisions which are being pronounced along with the decisions taken by the government as to what exactly are we included and what exactly are we excluding in the whole concept of concerns. So percentage, these are, you know, and especially the second limb of the provision talks about such shareholders. It doesn't talk about a shareholder. The first thing says shareholders. The second and the third limb of the section, they only talk about such shareholder. So what is a such shareholder? That again becomes a very debatable issue. It's because such shareholders means what kind of a percentage he should be holding, whether it should be 10% or more, or if it is a combined family club business, then it could it be a kartas and his own percentage, and a kartas as a kartas percentage holding, should that be taken into consideration? So all these things are again evolving depending on the facts of the cases and judicial pronouncement and the decisions taken by various courts and of course the department. And the third part, which I feel which is most ticklish about this provision, which I think we need again to be very careful about, is it is the payment made by the company on behalf or for the individual benefit. So the Act itself does not define as to what is on behalf and what is for individual benefit. So again, it opens, it again leaves a very open-ended kind of a thing that what exactly amounts to a benefit or what exactly is on behalf of someone. So certain times it happens that a husband gives a loan to a company and that company gives a loan to a wife, you know, so whether that amount to on behalf of or in for an individual benefit. So again, there are a lot of case laws. I'm sure you guys are totally aware about it. I need not emphasize on the case laws. So all these things combined together makes this deeming provision a little more strict. And over the years, which we have seen, it is again been interpreting. It is being interpreted by the department very strictly. And even the judiciary is also, as Supreme Court very correctly says, that it has to be strictly interpreted because it is a deeming provision. It is not a deeming provision. It is not a provision which is very categorically defined. So therefore, whenever we are putting a case into that bracket, we have to see that all the ingredients of a deeming provision are satisfied. Then only we can, you know, say that a person is covered under it is a deemed dividend or not. So basically, I think I will not go into too much details about the case laws and all. I'm sure it's all available on the social media and various sites of the here. And I think that's the basic concept behind deemed dividend, is that it is definitely an anti-abuse, and we are trying to plug in as much as we want. The moment there is a kind of an accession where something new comes up, then again, you know, we through the judicial pronouncement, we try to cover it up. So I think that's the basic concept. And I think when we take up the question answers, I think we have very smart people with us who will be able to technically handhold us and let us know where we are lacking and where we can improve, and maybe we can bring about some amendments or whatever. Thank you,
Mita. Thank you for giving a nice deep insight and the fair explanation of things. Now come to the Rakesh Gupta ji. Over to you, Rakesh, to explain this ticklish issue and solve problems of people. Anybody has any query, please send it to us. We'll give reply to all queries. Over to Rakesh ji.
Thank you, Shri Amit Mohan Govil, Honorable Principal Commissioner of Income Tax, Madam Smita Singh, Honorable Commissioner of Income Tax, my partner, senior partner, Dr. Raj Agrawal, and Mr. Pawan Vijay. Though Mr. Pawan has said that I must explain this concept of deemed dividend, now it is a fiction. And as Honorable Madam has already spoken, that this is a very draconian provision, in the sense that it catches you when you are fast asleep. Even you may not be aware. And on one fine morning, the tax authorities say, oh, you have crossed the Lakshman Rekha. And even if you want to trace your steps back, the damage is done. This is what this section of deemed dividend. Now, the section says that any payment made by a company in which public is not substantially interested, meaning thereby a payment made by a closely held company to a shareholder who is beneficially entitled to its shareholding not less than 10%. If it has given loan to such shareholder or for his benefit or to any concern in which he has got more than 20% stake, then to the extent of the accumulated profits, such closely held company will be deemed to have distributed the dividend to the shareholder. Now, if you ask me that this is such a section, now if you ask me to express in by way of a Hindi proverb, the gagar mein sagar, within these much expressions, I mean, what not has not been said. But then the first question, which Honorable Madam also answered, as to what was the rationale and logic behind the enactment of this section, not only under 1961 Act, but under the erstwhile 1922 Act also. There used to be tax on the distributed income. If you remember, there used to be section 104 under this Act. Those section doesn't exist anymore. Later on, it came in the form of the dividend distribution tax. So the feeling, impression at the level of the department or the legislature was that instead of declaring dividend and thus bypassing the provisions to tax on the distributed income, the loans or advances are given to the shareholders, and therefore this kind of a provision should be enacted, and accordingly it has been enacted. And not only has it been enacted, but when it was challenged on the constitutional touchstone before the court have said, no, these provisions have been enacted to achieve a very human objective, and therefore they should be upheld. But then kindly see, how does this object gel with the practical reality? Now, a shareholder who holds 10% shareholding, now you can very well understand that he may well be in minority and he holds 10%. Now, if there is any concern in which he holds 20% stake, and if this company grants loan to that concern in which this person is holding 20% stakes, even 20% also is a minority. Now, to the extent of the loan given by this closely held company to that concern in which the shareholder has got more 20% or more stakes, now that will be treated, that loan or advance will be treated as dividend in the hands of the shareholder. Now, he may not be knowing as a minority shareholder in this lending company that any loan has been given by this company to a concern in which also he holds minority stake. But then the fiction under section 222E is that he should pay the tax on such amount of loan or advance which he has not received. The concern in which he holds 20% has received. Now, to what is the mechanism for the shareholder to know, he being in minority, as to what is the accumulated profits of this lending company? Now, he may not have access as on the date on which the said loan was given from this closely held company to that concern as to what was the amount of accumulated profits of this lending company as on that day. Now, kindly see the impracticality. But then the legislature in its wisdom has enacted the fiction that something which cannot even be termed as income, even in the farthest sense of the term, now would be called as a dividend. And since the dividend can be taxed in the hands of the shareholder, therefore it is the shareholder who has to be punished for the payment which this lending company has made. I can understand if he has received the loan, if he is the beneficiary of that loan, and then he is made to pay tax, that can make some sense, though not fully, but then it can make some sense. But then a third person is receiving loan from this first person. Now this person, who is somewhat a very weak link, now he is made to pay tax. That is what the provision of the deemed dividend. Now, it says the loan or advance, as madam has also spoken as to what is the nature of advance. That is very important, because the word advance is in the company of the word loan, and that is what the principle of Adjus Dem Generis, which says that the meaning of a term will have to be given from the meaning of the word under whose company this word is placed. So that advance has to be in the nature of loan. Only then that advance can be roped in within the ambit of section 222E. So any advance which has been given in the ordinary course of a business, which cannot be said in the nature of loan, therefore cannot be intended to be roped in within the meaning of loan or advance. And therefore, if a lending company has given advance in the ordinary course of the business, now that advance, but then the substance, form may be different, but then the substance is that you have tried to give a camouflaged color to a loan as if it is an advance, then obviously the departmental authorities are entitled to pierce that veil and then reach to the bottom of the substance. So that has to be borne in mind. As madam has already spoken, that for the benefit. So if the benefit by way of loan or advance is sought to be given in direct manner, and that there is a link that you have given to this and this person, but that person has passed this amount of loan to the shareholder who is holding more than 10% shareholding or 20% stakes in some other concern, then there is a problem, because the Supreme Court in one of the decision has said that if the indirect route has been adopted, then obviously that indirect route can always be gone into by the departmental authorities in order to find that this benefit is sought to be passed on in an indirect manner. Now, this section is applicable in case of a closely held company. So not all closely held companies, though the section says the company in which public is not substantially interested. Therefore, if there is a company which may ostensibly be a closely held company, but then which can be categorized and held as a company in which public is substantially interested because of the special relationship this company enjoys under Section 2, Clause 18 of the Income Tax Act, then even if ostensibly it is a closely held company, but then cannot be treated as closely held company for the purpose of deemed dividend. So if you see Section 2, Clause 18 of the Income Tax Act, now it specifies certain relationships, even in respect of certain closely held companies. If those relationships do persist in case of the closely held company, then such closely held company may ostensibly be a closely held company, but then will not meet by the rigor of Section 2, Clause 22, Subclause E. Then definitely now it says that the shareholding. Therefore, the shareholding of that shareholder alone has to be seen. Even if he may be having, or his family members may be having the shareholding into that closely held company or in that concern in which the 20% limit has to be seen, then the courts have said, and even as per the plain reading of this section, it goes to suggest that standalone basis, his shareholding on a standalone basis has to be seen, and the shareholding of all the family members need not be taken into account in order to see whether he holds 10% or more in a company or not. Now, there is somewhat confusion in some quarters whether the loan given to such shareholder or to his concern in which he holds more than 20%, if it has been given on a reasonably good interest bearing. And in that situation, whether the rigor of Section 222E can be obviated or avoided or not. Definitely not. Unless, of course, that lending is part of your business and lending has been done in the ordinary course of the business of such company. Barring these two situations, or barring in this one situation where the lending is the main business of the lending company and this lending has been given in the ordinary course of the lending business, only then the amount given in the ordinary course of the business on interest may not be categorized as deemed dividend. Now, of course, there is under Section 194, now there is a requirement for the company in case such a distribution has taken place, distribution in the form of loan or advance has taken place, which because of this peculiar parameters of Section 222E would constitute dividend, that company is required to withhold tax at the rate of 10%. And since deemed dividend will have to be paid, or the tax on the deemed dividend will have to be paid as shareholder, therefore this tax will have to be deducted for and on behalf or in the name of the shareholder, and then that shareholder will claim the credit. But later on, this company happens to declare dividend and wants to set off the dividend against this loan or advance, then the second distribution of the actual dividend will not be taxable in the hands of a shareholder. That is what also it has been said. And what important is, one more element is the existence and the availability of the accumulated profit of the lending company as on the date of the grant of advance. So if the accumulated profits have resulted after the loan having been given, then also it cannot be treated as deemed dividend. So the position of the accumulated profits will have to be computed on each day of the loan or advance having been given by this lending company. And once an amount is to be treated as deemed dividend, this very important thing which I am going to share. Now, if any amount of loan or advance is to be treated as deemed dividend, such a dividend may not have been taxed in the hands of the shareholders, but even then such amount of the loan or advance which is to be treated as deemed dividend will have to be reduced notionally. There is an impression that unless an amount of loan or advance has been taxed as deemed dividend, the accumulated profits will not be reduced. But the law is not like this. The accumulated profits will have to be reduced notionally with the amount of loan or advance which is to be treated as deemed dividend, whether that amount has actually been taxed or not. That is what the law is. So it may appear to be somewhat very uncanny kind of a situation, but then that is the position of law. So, of course, there is a distinction between the equity shareholder, the preference shareholders. So, if the shareholder is holding the preference shares, then the conditions or the rigor of section 222E would not cover the preference shareholders, even if any amount of loan or advance has been given to the preference shareholder. Because this section says that the shareholder should be one whose shareholding should not carry the fixed rate of dividend, whether with or without the right of further participating in the profits or not. So this is not applicable in case of the preference shareholders. This is applicable in case of the equity shareholders having the voting right. So this shareholder to whom the loan or advance is to be given is to be treated as deemed dividend to the extent of accumulated profit must be the shareholder whose shareholding should command the voting right. That is what the section says. So these are a few of the things which I thought that I must share with deemed dividend. Though madam has already spoken the various aspects and facets, but I remember because I had an occasion to be a party to the decision in Ankitech declared by, pronounced by the Delhi High Court in 340 ITR. Because this section does not mention that if at all the loan or advance has been given, though it says that it will constitute dividend, but then it will be taxable in whose hands? The board's stand as per circular 495 used to be that the recipient of the loan or advance would be the appropriate entity in whose hands such amount should be taxed. But then the court said, and now that has found approval from the Supreme Court in Madhuram Housing. So that is a different matter that in a later decision, I mean, this aspect has been referred to the larger bench, and the matter is still under active consideration before the larger bench of the Supreme Court. But so far as the position of law is concerned, that irrespective of the beneficiary of that loan or advance, it is the shareholder and the shareholder alone who has to be taxed in respect of this amount. Because the concept of dividend is direct, proximate, inextricably linked with the shareholding or the shareholder. And therefore, the courts have said that the loan may have been taken by the concern in which the shareholder has got more than 20% stake or the beneficial interest. But when it comes to the taxation of that loan, now that concern may not be the appropriate persons to be taxed, but then the shareholder will be the person in whose hands this amount of loan. So this makes all the more the impact of this deemed dividend provisions if I am permitted to in the draconian manner. Now regarding the deemed income, as Amitji have already spoken about and has given a very overview of all those section 68, 69 ABC, and then section 56 subsection 2 clause 10, then 50C, 50CA and 43C, 43CA, and all those sections. I mean, they, because the deemed income means the income by its very nature, they are not income, but because of the fiction which has been provided by the legislature, such receipts are income. Like under section 56 to 10, the gifts or the receipt of immovable property at less than the stamp duty value, or the receipt of movable property at less than the stamp duty value. So in normal circumstances, that will constitute as capital receipt. And but for the enactment of section 56 to 10, these receipts could not have been brought to be taxed under the Income Tax Act. And that is why they are called the deemed income. Similarly, under section 68 or 69, they're all capital receipts. That if the sum is found created in the books of account and you are not able to explain the nature and source, or for that matter, if you have made investment, whether it is recorded in your books of account or not, but then if you are not able to explain about the nature and source of the funds used by you in making the investment in those assets, then to the extent you are not able to explain the nature and source, they will be deemed to be your income from undisclosed. That is what. And similarly, section 69C, that if you have incurred some expenditure and you have not been able to explain the nature and source, not the nature but the source of that the source out of which this expenditure has been incurred, then section 69C says that that expenditure will be deemed to have been made from your income from undisclosed source. So these are the deeming fictions. Now section 56-10 now is a section of very recent origin and is unfurling several issues of larger public interest. Therefore, I think, I mean, I will deal certain issues relating to section 56-10. Now it says that if a person after a particular date, that date is no longer relevant for us because now we are already in 2020. So if a person is in receipt of a sum of money without consideration, then that amount, if it is of 50,000 rupees or more, then that would constitute income in there, unless there are exceptions, unless you fall into those exceptions. If you are relative or the gift has been given on the occasion of the marriage, so on and so forth. There's a long list of exclusions. Similarly, if you have received an immovable property, either by way of gift or even if you have purchased it, but that the consideration paid by you is less than the stamp duty value by more than rupees 50,000, then the difference would constitute income. That is what section 56-10b says. There are certain provisos also, safe harbor rules, as Amit has also said, that now that has been made to 10%. And similarly, if you are in the receipt of a movable property, and movable property, the property word has been defined, and that includes the shares and securities. Now, if you happen to receive the movable property, let us be precise, suppose shares and securities, at a consideration which is less than the fair market value, and that the difference is 50,000 rupees or more, then that will constitute income. But then the fair market value. Fair market value, as Amit ji also said, has been defined under Rule 11UA. And that has been defined in a very unique manner. And how would the shareholder who is transferring his share, or the person who is receiving the share or purchasing the share, would determine as to what is the fair market value of those shares as on the valuation date? Because that would require so many information from the company's balance sheet, and not only from the company's balance sheet, but then if there are immovable properties, then what is the stamp duty value of those properties as on the valuation date? And if a shareholder holding a minuscule percentage of the shareholding, now he happens to sell those shares, and therefore it requires to be determined as to what is the fair market value in terms of Rule 11, because determination of that fair market value of those shares is important for the sellers also and for the buyers. Now that will pose immensely difficult practical situations. Now, as Pavanji has spoken about one or two instances. Now, even in respect of the quoted shares, now, if as on the date of valuation, it was not quoted or the quoted rates are not available, then you will have to go on some date in the past on which date it was quoted. And the time gap as on the valuation date and the date for which the date is to be taken is substantial. Now, that may not be actually the fair market value, but then the fiction which has been enacted under Rule 11UA, now that is going to present a very distorted form of the fair market. And that kind of a fair market value may be substantially unfair in itself. But then that is what the provision is like this. And since the rules have been made, rules are the part of the delegated legislations, the departmental authorities would say that we are bound by it. and there is no laxity, there is no ambivalence, there is no variation which is permissible to us. Therefore, we'll go strictly, and they are the fictional provisions. They are the deeming provisions. Therefore, they have to be constituted very strictly. Whether for or against of either of the party, they have to be constituted very strictly. That is what the law is. The loan which is waived. Now, whether should constitute income under section 56 to 10? When 56 to 10 was not there, the department used to invoke section 28 clause 4. The department used to invoke section 41(1), but then the very invoking of section 41(1) used to be shot down on the ground that 41(1) is applicable in respect of any deduction which has been availed by you in the past and the remission of which has been received by you. And since in respect of the loan, you have never claimed this amount as a deduction, therefore there was no question of invoking section 41(1). But then the department used to shift that there is section 28, there is section 28 clause 4 which says the value of any benefit or perquisite, whether convertible money or not. Then the courts have said that it is in respect of the non-monetary benefit. Now, after 56 to 10, now it has become a raging controversy that where the loan has been waived and to the extent of the waiver, can you be said to be in the receipt of money? Because section 56 to 10 A says that when a person receives a sum of money, the department says that you have received the sum of money. That sum of money may have been waived by the bank on whatever considerations. But then those considerations are not the adequate considerations, or that waiver will be said to be without consideration. But then the opponent of this view says that though there is a waiver, but the receipt of sum of money is not in this year. So this is a debatable question, but according to me, now it cannot be roped under section 56 to 10. But then the department now is bound to take this kind of an interpretation in times to come. Then Pavanji raised the issue of the initial issue of shares by a company, because there is section 56 to 7B and then 56 to 10C. 56 to 7B says 56 subsection 2 clause 7 small b, that if a closely held company receives any considerations for the issuance of shares above than the face value but lesser than the and above the market value, fair market value of the shares, then the excess amount of consideration received by this closely held company over and above the fair market value will constitute income under section 56 to 7B. And under section 56 to 7C, the recipient or the purchaser of the shares . The question comes in case of section 56 to 10C, that when the shares are issued at a price less than the stamp duty value, less than the fair market value, then this buyer or the subscriber of the share can be said to have derived any income under section 56 to 10C. Similarly, when the right issues are made by the company, then there can be two situations, that the rights are supposed to be given evenly in proportion to the shareholding and all the shareholders have subscribed for that right. Or there may well be a situation that some of the shareholders may have renounced their rights, and those renounced shares may have been taken by the existing shareholders. Similarly, the bonus shares are issued, and for bonus shares, now there is no consideration involved, ostensible consideration. Therefore, in all these situations, the question comes whether the recipient of the shares can be said to have received the shares, which is a property, for a consideration which is less than the fair market value. Obviously, in respect of the initial issue of shares, when the issue price is less than the fair market value of the shares, then there should not be any reason for somebody to believe that it is not an income. Yes, it is income. The differential will constitute income. In case of the right issue of shares, if the rights have been subscribed by the existing shareholders the way it has been allotted, then obviously everybody is receiving the share, everybody is receiving the shares in that proportions, therefore there may not be any income. Or even if income is there and they are related, then because of this transactions taking place between the relatives, there may not be any implication of section 56 to 10c. When the bonus shares are issued, now bonus shares are issued out of the reserves and surplus to which all the shareholders are entitled alike, and therefore these shareholders, instead of having the benefit of reserve and surplus, now are having the benefit in the form of the bonus shares, which is nothing but the capitalized profit. And therefore, in that situation, the form of benefit has undergone a change, and therefore nothing more is being received by the shareholders when they happen to receive the bonus shares. And similar kind of a question comes in case of the buyback of shares. When the shares are bought by the company at lesser than the fair market value, suppose the face value is 10 rupees, fair market value say of 21 rupees, but this company buys back the share at say rupees 60. So for 6 rupee, that is the difference between 16 and 10. Now that will be taxed in the hands of the company as income distribution under section 115 QA. The 6 rupee which the shareholder would get is considered as exempt under section 10 subsection 34 capital A. But then the differential from 21 to 16, which on the face of it the company is going to derive a benefit if it goes in for the buyback of the shares, now whether it would constitute income in the hands of the company, that is the issue. If you see section 68 of the Companies Act 2013, then the shares are required to be destroyed. And therefore, in the light of these peculiar provisions of the Companies Act, the courts have said that company does not receive anything, and the receipt of something is a prerequisite as per the rule of literal construction section 56 subsection 2 clause 10 subclause C. And therefore, in respect of the buyback of shares, the difference between the fair market value and the buyback price would not constitute any income in the hands of the company which is buying back the shares. There are many
issues. Just a little question in this, that when you talk about all three categories, that is rights issue, bonus issue, and buyback.
Yes.
In the case of listed securities, that is quoted shares, there should not be any problem because the law is unambiguous and clear. It is only when the shares are off-market transactions or unquoted or unlisted shares, will this issue of price determination in the hands of either the shareholder or the company for capital gains purpose or shareholder for receipt of income from other sources come into play? That is 50CA or 56210C will come into play. So just I would like you to, for the perspective of the viewers, clarify on this point.
Yes. So the shares, whether quoted or unquoted, and they constitute property for the purpose of section 56 to 10c. So if the shares are quoted, but then these are the off market transactions at a price which is lesser than the fair market value, then also in terms of rule 11 UA, the differential will constitute income read with section 56 to 10c. So that is what one of the questions which Pavanji has forwarded, where the price has been determined with the intervention of the National Company Law Tribunal, and even in that situation, because nothing has been envisaged under the scheme, under either under section 56-10 or under rule 11 UA. Therefore,
but for that circular has come out for NCLT transactions. The circular dated 28 June has come out from the CBDT.
Okay, that says
I am not too sure, but if there is a finding by the tribunal, there's a circular that has come out by the CBDT which exempts certain category from being determined as this thing. So it is a circular dated 20th June. So if anybody of Pawan's office can research and put it up, so they could see it. It's a 20th June dated 2020. Yes.
So Pawanji, now I think it's 5:15. Raji has also to speak, and there are several questions. So I think that I will give quietus to my deliberation this stage, and then we will take up the questions.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Rakesh. Thank you very much for giving a detailed deliberation on this issue. So should we start questions, or RK, you want to say something, and then we can.
As you wish, we can start questions, or just I can make brief comment for just on the issues which have already been discussed.
Yeah, please.
So the point is regarding deemed dividend, because this deeming provision is such a big issue. If we see in the under the Income Tax Act, there are more than 30 provisions where deeming friction has been created. So therefore, I mean, to discuss all the provisions, it is not possible within this short time. We have taken two issues. One is deemed dividend, and there is section 56-210 or 27B, etc. Now, so far as deemed dividend is concerned, all the earlier speakers who have spoken, they have said that this provision is draconian, this is impractical, this is not achieving the object for which it was enacted, because a 10% shareholder is being can be taxed on the whole of the amount of loan which has been given to a concern in which he is simply a 20% stakeholder. So that is not the objective for which this kind of provision was brought. So therefore, I feel when we talk of the simplification and reforms in the direct tax laws, this provision should go. That is my submission to the regulator. But before that happens, I would like the corporate world, because corporate world is largely impacted by this provision and unnoticed. Nobody plans to pay loan in lieu of dividend, and therefore the provision of TDS will hardly be triggered, because nobody plans that way. Rather, it becomes accidentally due to default. Due to oversightness, and even if you have done the transaction for a day, next day somebody tells us this is wrong, you are caught. So therefore, this provision, so far as the planning is concerned for the corporate world, they should, within, if they are having so many companies within the corporate structure, within the associated concerns, then they should look into the shareholding structure of their companies, that if there are frequent transactions where money is transferred from one company to another to and it is returned back, then they should try to plan the shareholding structure in such a manner that this provision is not hit. As Rakesh ji told, that this provision is hit when you are a 10% shareholder. Individually it is to be seen. The shareholding of the relatives, even of the spouse or the children, is not clubbed together. So therefore, you can plan in such a manner that in one company you have one shareholder, other family members can be shareholder in other companies. I mean, some kind of planning can be done so that the frequent violation of this provision does not happen, and you are not caught unnecessarily for paying the taxes, which are never intended to take benefit of, but due to the only accident. So that is one thing. Secondly, the point which Rakesh ji told, and one of the queries also there, that only up to accumulated profit If loan has been given, there can be taxability under this section. And while seeing the accumulated profit, even the loans or advances which have been given in earlier years but not taxed will also be notionally reduced. So this is also a very important aspect to look into whenever any violation has happened, whether this violation can be defended or it cannot be defended, in keeping in view the position of law as explained in this manner and which has been pronounced by the courts also in many judgments. So this is another point which the corporate world may keep in mind. Now, so far as the deeming income is concerned, we discussed an issue regarding the right issue. Rakesh ji very well told regarding the right issue or the bonus, etc. These will not be covered within the ambit of section 56. For the reason that money was already belonging to the shareholder. Bonus share, when these are being given, that money was kept in the company but belonging to the shareholder. If it has been given to the person to whom it belonged, then nothing additional has been received. That is one of the logic behind this also, that in the case of bonus share right issue, but when preferential issue is there, then there is a controversy. There is a vertical division even within the experts also, that in the case of preferential share, if it is being issued at a price less than the fair market value, whether it can be taxed in the hands of the shareholders, there is a vertical division between the experts also. Some view is that it will be taxed, and the view is also there that it will not be taxed. The reason or the argument for this is that company does not give the shares. Company issue the shares. Shares are not the property of the company. When company is issuing the shares, then we cannot say that company has given anything. But the person is receiving not from the company. Rather, the rights of the other shareholders are impacted by this. So therefore, whatever you are receiving, not from the company, but this is the curtailment of the rights of the other shareholders. So there can be so many arguments both sides, but this is a gray area on which there is no clarification so far from the department side. And we will have to look into that, what kind of law develops in course of time. Only then we can say that whether it would be taxable or it may not be taxable. Other queries which Pawan has thrown have mostly been discussed by Rakesh ji. So now we can start taking the questions. Lot of questions have come. Pawan, we can start with the questions.
Okay. Now, let me just start the questions, and I will just tell you the process of questions. We have received more than 50 questions. So some questions are very small ones. Some questions are detailed ones. So what I'll do, last 10 to 15 minutes, I'll do rapid round where you have to give yes and no, no discussion. But initially we can do discussion also. And suppose Rakesh or Rajkumar is giving answer and Amit and Meeta wants to add something, so just tell me so you can add your point. Now, one point which I'm starting with this, Amit Hemmon has just now mentioned and Rakesh Gupta ji has mentioned, just tell clearly whether this section 56 applies to listed company or it is applied to unlisted company. That is the one question. I'll ask you the next question, because the discussion has created some confusion. So whether the listed company or unlisted company?
No, insofar as 56 to 7B is concerned, obviously it is applicable in case of a company which is a closely held company or a company in which public is not substantially interested.
Okay.
But in case of 56 to 10C, when the property is being received, maybe in the form of shares, that may be the shares of any company. If it's being received by this person at lesser than the fair market value, then this income is to be taxed in the hands of the recipient.
Okay, clearly. Now, there was a one case of Sudhir K. Menon versus ACIT.
Yes.
Mumbai. Right issue and bonus issue. So the department was, can such receipt of shares be regarded as receipt of property without consideration or inadequate consideration? Yes. And was decided that issue of bonus share is a merely capitalization, which RK was saying, of profit of a company, no receipt of property.
Yes.
Okay. And the second is the right issue proportionate allotment in case of right issue, no receipt of property. So, yes. So the point is, suppose I'm allotting shares on right basis to all the shareholders, and then it was a decide, it was I think in the same case, and there is no change in shareholding, then right issue is exempted. But if the amount is because right issue as per SEBI law, you can give any amount. So 100 rupees shares, you can give at 30 rupees. So the 70 rupees is gap. Now today, right renunciation is there. Reliance right renunciation was tradable in the market. So if I'm selling my right, I'm using 50% shares and 50% I'm selling, then my shareholding pattern will change. And the shareholding will not be the same. In that case, it will be applicable to all the shareholders that they have, the change has taken place.
No, the recipient of the share as a result of renunciation of somebody else's right. Now, whether he has received those shares at lesser than the fair market value, now that has to be seen, and it will constitute income. And that is what Mumbai bench of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal in the case of Sudhir Menon said.
Okay. Now I'm coming to this one question has come. This public are not substantially interested.
Yes.
And then listed company and public company. Now this is not a confusing thing because either you have a listed company or unlisted company, but unlisted companies also public can be substantially interested. So how to make this difference?
Hey, Pavanji, now if it is a public company which is not a company in which public is substantially interested, meaning thereby that ostensibly, apparently, it is a closely held company, but that under section 2 clause 18, there are a couple of provisions which say that even such a company, if it is 100% subsidiary of a listed company, would also be treated as a company in which public is substantially interested. And that is how I always say that do not go by the initial categorization of that company with reference to which you are benchmarking or seeing the transaction. You must see whether this company can be said to be a company the public is substantially interested on the parameters of section 2 clause 18.
Okay. So now I'm taking some questions. One question is on deemed dividend. When in one person company sells his shares to another person, whether the gain will be assessed under capital gain, deemed dividend under other sources or business income?
Should I answer?
Yes.
So, in fact, the intention of making or holding a particular thing that determines as to whether he was holding it as capital asset or he was holding as a trading asset. So, even if it was a one-person company and he's selling these shares, and then obviously he held these shares in the company as a measure of investment. Not as a measure of the trading asset. Therefore, this will constitute the capital gain and will not be business income.
Okay. In case of shares of unlisted company are transferred below the price determined by registered valuer, will this transaction be subject to deemed dividend provision?
No, this transaction will not be within the ambit of deemed dividend. Deemed dividend is altogether a different aspect, which we have discussed. This is when a corporate gives loan to a shareholder to a concern in which shareholder is having a substantial interest. Only then deemed dividend comes into. Here in this case, there may be the affection of provision of section 56 to 10.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Rakesh, as per rule 11 UA, for quoted unquoted shares, valuation should be done by merchant banker. Can IBB registered valuer can also issue valuation report as per the alternative to merchant banker?
No. When 11 UA subrule 2, now when it specifically says that the merchant banker alone is competent to issue certificate, and read with section 56 to 7B explanation, then merchant banker alone is competent to issue certificate.
Okay. Valuation under section 56.10 can also be done by registered valuer, specified valuer as specified under the act. That is also there.
Pardon?
52.10. 56210, the registered value of new valuation.
Under 56210, valuation can be by any valuer. It is not merchant banker which is required.
Okay.
No, okay.
Yeah. Okay. My client wants to sell agricultural land in rural area where stamp duty valuation is 21 lakh, but sales consider decided 16 lakh as per the exemption. But whether section 56 will attract, please advise.
Now, this is a very debatable question. Whether the rural agricultural land, which is an immovable property, and if it is received by a person at a consideration which is less than the stamp duty value, whether the differential will constitute income or not. If we go by the rule of literal construction, maybe in the hands of the seller, since this does not constitute a capital asset, he may not end up in paying any tax or capital gains, but the recipient may be taxed under section 56210. The only decision which was available on this topic was the decision of the Jaipur bench of the tribunal in the case of Trilok Chand Sen. But I have been told that that decision has been recalled, and therefore there is no authoritative pronouncement on this point. But then, going by the rule of literal construction, there may be a problem.
Okay.
One point which I can add here, because this is a gray area and the very debatable issue, but if there is a difference of 21 lakh and 16 lakh, so 5 lakh can be treated as a gift in the hands of the person who has received at a lesser value. If it is treated as a gift, then the 56 section 56 should not be attracted for the reason that it is in the exempt category. It is not taxable. So of course it is debatable.
Okay, Rakesh, tell me, if the valuation of the property is less and it is in the it is a normal in Delhi, and the circle price is higher and the value of the market is less, even then the circle price that will be deemed as the income?
No, then there is an option that if the person objects to his assessing officer that you appoint district valuation officer for determining the fair market value, then the assessing officer will appoint district valuation officer, and in case the district valuation officer values it lesser than the stamp duty value, then that price will be, that valuation will be deemed to be the consideration.
Okay. There is a question that people are asking, that all regulators are modifying during the COVID period various sections. So at present today, the market value of all immovable property is very less. So suppose somebody is doing transaction and the circle rate is higher, then the income tax department should not give a order that it can be considered for during that period.
No, Ravi, Rakesh just answered that question, that in case if there is a dispute, it can be referred to a valuation officer, and that valuation officer, the assessing officer will be bound by the value declared by the valuation officer. So, in case, yeah.
Okay. Or RK, is company liable to pay DDT on dividend, deemed dividend?
Now DDT is gone. Now it is taxable in the hands of the shareholder.
Okay. Rakesh, you have given answer of this question. Company A is individual shareholder holding more than 25% in B Private Limited and C Private Limited. Further, B Private Limited gives loan to C Private Limited. Will the loan amount attract deemed dividend on Mr. A, as he holds 25% share in C Limited, recipient company?
Yes.
Okay. As per provisions of law, yes.
Okay. RK, in case of current account transaction where regular debit and credit transaction takes place, whether the provision of deemed dividend are attracted?
Because the point is, current account transactions are also in the nature of advance.
Yes.
When these are in the nature of advance, if there is no business connection, these are not in the nature of business advance, then provision of 222E will be affected.
Okay, Rakesh, how to comply with section 194 TDS in case of loans and advance considered as deemed dividend?
So the company which is giving loan or advance now will have to see, having regard to the accumulated profits as on the date of the grant of loan or advance, and to the person or to the concern to whom the loan or advance has been given, whether it will fit into the definition of dividend. And if yes, then the company is obliged to deduct the TDS.
Okay. In case of company has accumulated losses for profit in current year, can provision of deemed dividend applies?
So the position of accumulated profits will have to be seen as on the date of the grant. So if there are brought forward losses which outweigh the current year's profit up to the date of the grant of loan, then there will be accumulated loss. There will not be accumulated profit, and therefore there is no question of any deemed dividend.
Okay. RK, if company has sold his fixed asset, flat or shop to its director at stamp duty valuation or more, and instead of recovering the amount, it kept as a receivable from him, whether it will attract section 222E?
Yes, the amount, again the amount receivable is what is the nature. The amount receivable when you have sold the property and you have to receive back the amount from the director which is outstanding, it becomes in the nature of advance. Then the provision will be affected.
Okay. Amit and Meeta, I'm not asking this technical questions. I'm asking as soon as the some policy decision will come, I'll ask you this question. Okay, but in case anywhere where you want to add, just please add. Rakesh, sure. If AEO assess rent as deemed income and SSC accept the same and pay tax demand, is section 271C applicable on SSC on account of inaccurate or concealment of income?
Normally, I mean, the penalty under 271C is not imposed, or if at all it is imposed, then now it may be deleted by the appellate authority, because the fictions, but then if the fiction is so evident that the SSC ought to have applied that fiction and then ought to have computed income in that way, then some appellate authorities tend to take a different view, that merely because it is a fictional income and therefore even if you could have applied the fiction, you did not apply, and yet you say that you have not furnished an accurate particulars of income. So
okay.
But normally in the case of fictional income, a lenient view is taken, at least from the appellate authority's point of view. The assessing officer may be administratively or, I mean, is bound to impose penalty. Whether the additions are made, that is a different matter. But then the appellate authority tend to take a lenient.
Okay, friends, now we have questions are there and people are waiting to get the reply. So I'm just extending time. RK, whether the fund received from subsidiary company for making a strategic investment by its holding company are liable to tax as deemed dividend? If the answer is yes, what is the relevant date for ascertaining the accumulated profit for the purpose of deemed dividend?
Well, under the provision of 222E, there is no distinction or no exemption to holding and subsidiary company. So therefore, it will be affected. But so far as the date is concerned, it will be the date on which the amount or loan or advance is given. On that date, we will see what are the accumulated profits. If the balance sheet can be drawn up to that date, that is the good evidence. But if it cannot be drawn up to that date, then the last audited balance sheet can be taken to look into the accumulated profits.
Okay.
But Pavanji, may I add here, there is one Andhra Pradesh High Court decision now which says that in case of the relationship between the holding and subsidiary company, section 222E would not be attracted. So that is an isolated decision, but then that is that there is a judicial decision to this effect. Barring that decision, there is a problem because that fits into the scheme of section 222E.
Okay. Rakesh, if the immovable property, that is clubhouse, is transferred by the builder to a resident welfare association by way of relinquishment deed, will it be deemed income and who is liable to tax?
The immovable clubhouse is transferred by the builder to the resident welfare association by way of relinquishment deed. Now, yeah. can it be said that the resident welfare association has received that property without consideration?
I think he's saying this one.
Let me think. I'll come back. Let me think.
Okay. RK, if loan to shareholder remains outstanding and company further accumulated profit over the period, loan remains outstanding, will the deemed dividend applicable on extra profit generated by company every year?
It can be for the new loan given, not for the earlier loan, it can be covered up.
Okay. Rakesh, where loan is taxed as a deemed dividend in one assessment year, and later one loan is returned by the recipient, where the same can be treated oblique claimed as expense by the recipient in the next financial year?
There is no concept of claiming an expenditure. Once the loan has been taxed as deemed dividend, that is the end of the matter. Only effect is that amount which has been treated as deemed dividend will be reduced notionally from the amount of total accumulated profits.
Okay. RK, where the issue of right issue is at least then fair market value, out of 10 shareholder, 9 shareholder subscribe and 1 does not subscribe, then it will be deemed income for one shareholder who has not subscribed?
We have already debated this issue from different angles, and there are divergent views, but I think in the case of right issue, even then there is a renunciation, it should not be taxed under section 56 to 10.
Okay. Rakesh, in the case of closely held company, if substantial interest of one of the common shareholder has been reduced to less than 20% by the recipient company in the month of February 2020, after reducing shareholding to less than 20%, lender company has given loan to recipient company in the same financial year, in the beginning of the year, and shareholder was holding 25% shareholding, whether section 222E will apply?
No, the position of law will have to be seen as on the date of the grant of loan or advance. Whether it is the position of accumulated profits, whether it is the position of shareholding, if on the date of grant of loan is shareholding has reduced from 20%, then obviously it will not be hit by section 222E.
Okay. Now I will not cover the big questions because time is less, so I'm just taking the small question. In case a right share made at the less than fair market value, if additional shares are subscribed and allotted to the existing members, whether 56.2x will be attracted? Now this is a different question. So you are entitled for 1 lakh shares, but you are getting additional shares of 2 lakh. So the 1 lakh extra you are getting, it's section 56.2x will applicable.
No, to this question, I want to modify this question, and I become part of the audience, and I am putting this question to Rakesh ji and Rajkumar ji. It's a very basic question. Isn't giving of right share or bonus share at fair market value? It's a very basic question.
I couldn't get Amitji, please, I'm so sorry.
No, if a company issues, a listed company issues a bonus share or a right share, the primary question, isn't the issue at fair market value?
No, many times, or rather,
so far bonus share is concerned. How does 56.10C come in?
So far as bonus shares are concerned, Amitji, the bonus shares are issued, I mean, without any ostensible consideration. And that is why the courts have said that instead of the shareholders entitled to reserves and surplus, now they have become entitled bonus shares.
Correct.
So the form has changed. Right. In case of the right shares, but then right shares are issued at lesser than the fair market value by most of the companies.
Fair enough. But they are issued to everybody. Whosoever exercises right, they are entitled to pick up that share. So the value at which a right issue is issued by a company publicly, isn't that the fair market value?
Fortunately, 11U has defined or has prescribed the determination of fair market in a particular manner. Therefore, even if the fair market, even if it has been offered at the market price, but then it may not necessarily fair market value in the sense of Rule 11 UA.
So in practice, does this question arise that if a publicly listed company, suppose Reliance issues some right shares, and does the valuation under 11 UA arise if somebody purchases right shares of Reliance or exercises their rights?
That is not applicable in case of quoted shares. That is applicable in case of unquoted shares.
That's the exact point I was making.
Okay, I have received a very interesting question. Rakesh ji, please explain. They are saying Riya Chakravarti got some money from Sushant Singh Rajput. So whether this pledge, if it is proved that he has taken money from Rajput's account or Rajput
he has taken.
So whether it will be a section 56 applicable or not?
No. she has taken or she received. There is a difference because if there is a receipt, then there has to be.
Both you give answer of both.
You're asking me?
I'm asking if she has received money, then what is the treatment? And she has taken money, what is the treatment?
So if she has received it without consideration, obviously that will constitute income in her hands under section 56 to 10A. But if she has misappropriated that amount, then obviously she cannot be said to have received it without consideration. There will be several considerations, then you will find.
Okay, I have received another question of Riya Chakravarti. They are saying you are saying relative is exempted. But live-in relationship is approved by the Supreme Court. So whether this live-in relationship will be approved as a relative or not?
No. I mean, relative has been defined under section 56 to 10, read me section 56 to 7. So, I mean, that live-in relationships kind is not recognized as a relationship.
Okay, but you recognize the children of live-in relationship, but you don't recognize as a person who can receive the money.
I mean, if the legislature in its wisdom has made the stepchildren as part of relative, then it's all right.
Okay. Amit, Meeta, you have any view on this?
Madam, you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah. What question was it? Can you repeat the question?
The question is the Riya Chakravarti's live-in relationship is allowed by Supreme Court and they accept their children. But definition of relative is not there in live-in relationship is not coming in definition of relative. But children is accepted, but property giving is not accepted. So that's why I was asking this question.
I think it requires a lot of interpretations.
So, Bhavan, if property or money is received by the children, then it will not be taxable.
Okay. The amount forfeited as advance received against sale of property, whether it will be taxable in the year of receipt of advance or in the year in which it was forfeited.
It was forfeited. So long as it was receipt of advance and was not forfeited, I mean, it would not constitute income. It would constitute income when that advance stood forfeited and became the property of the person who received it.
Okay. RK, how is accumulated profit for deemed dividend? Is it last 31st May where books have been drawn? Also, whether the accumulated profit is determined as per Companies Act or as per Income Tax Act?
No, accumulated profit is to be calculated firstly, as on the date on which transfer has taken place, but for any reason, the loan or advance has been given, but for any reason, it is not possible to calculate the accumulated profit for the fraction of the year, then the accumulated profit up to the last audited balance sheet may be taken for that purpose. What is your view?
I have to add, because the courts have said that you have to assume the profit of the year on pro rata basis up to the date of grant of loan or advance.
So judgments are to this effect also. So you have to see the pro rata profit for the purpose. And the profit is to be determined as per the Companies Act. not as per the Income Tax Act, because the balance sheet is prepared in accordance with the Companies Act.
Okay. Amit, there is a one question on policy matter has come. Loans and advance are integral to commerce and a progressive commercial activity in any corporate. 222E cannot be a wish list to eliminate genuine loans and advance activity in a commercial world. Given this, the section 222E needs to be abolished as it has yielded skewed result and more disputes. And as long as we have weak dispute resolution mechanism, the pleasure of doing business in India will be looked down upon. Is it not aligned to Vivek Vibad se Vishwas tak? Amit, your voice, please open it.
I'll give you an answer to this in a different perspective. You see, the big question, the big question is that whether you want investment to come in. But we have all our investment historically for the past 10-15 years when there was a favorable regime of double taxation avoidance agreement with Mauritius, all our FDI used to come in through Mauritius. And there was round tripping of money that was belonging to this country only. It was being round tripped through Mauritius and coming back into our own very country. So these are, as you correctly opened the discussion with, these are anti-abuse provisions. When there is a related party transaction, it has to be viewed with the lens of an arm's length pricing. It has to be seen whether that transaction, if there is an interlinkage of shareholding, be it minority, in this manner differ with Rakesh ji, be it minority shareholding. But if there is minority shareholding and there is transfer of loan, so then the taxpayer's duty also arises to show that it is a transparent above board transaction and it is not so much so in any manner a related party. So that is where the provisions of deemed dividend come. They are not anti-business, they are anti-abuse. So that should be kept in mind.
Okay. Rakesh ji, one question has come. Income tax department declared...
RK will be better to answer that question.
Okay, RK, Income Tax Department declared share capital received from three shareholders holding 40% of shares as bogus and collected tax with penalty. Now, company wants to remove that bogus capital from its books. What are the options available to the company? It should not trigger ED action if company go to NCLT and reduction under section company under section under Companies Act 2013.
In fact, there are different statutes, and when there are different statutes, the violation of each statute is to be looked into independently. Under the Income Tax Act, there may be bogus shareholding, you might have accepted and paid the tax on this. But if there is a violation simultaneously under the Companies Act, where fictitious shareholders have been created and there any kind of prosecution or any kind of penalty is there, you will have to face that also. So by paying the tax under the Income Tax Act on the income which was fictitious income introduced by you in the books in the garb of the shareholding taken from the others, if you cannot be absolved from the penalty and prosecution or the punishment under the all other statutes, wherever I mean, it may be Benami Act, it may be PMLA, it may be Companies Act, wherever there can be actions, you will have to face all the actions.
Okay. And now there are, I will confine to 4 or 5 questions only, which I have received. Rakesh, in case of allotment by unlisted company, if the issue price including premium is less than the fair market value under section 56(2)(b)(7)(b), where is no deemed income taxable, is there any deemed income in the hands of allottee as per section 56(2)(10), read with rule 11 UA, as allottee has paid issue price less than the fair market value?
In the hands of the company, it will not constitute income. because the issue price is less than the fair market value, but then the converse may not be true in case of the receiver of the share. So there may be problem in the hands of the receiver of the share.
Okay, RK, considering
Pavan, there is a very good question which you have left. Let me just address this question.
Yeah.
In case of allotment by unlisted company, it is by Archana. In case of allotment by unlisted company,
I have asked the same question. Rakesh has given answer.
Okay. It has been dealt and it's okay.
RK, considering the intercorporate deposit provision in Companies Act, whether such intercorporate deposit would be deemed dividend under section 220E if all condition of such section is fulfilled?
Yes. I will give answer, because in fact there are judicial decisions to this effect that it will not constitute deemed dividend. But yes, there are judicial decisions to this effect.
Amit, why this public are not substantially interested, we are covering. But in fact, there are so many statutes, they talked about the control. Even if you are controlling without holding shares. But here you are talking about the 10% shares. So is it not that we should see the holistic view, not only the shareholding?
See, everywhere when there is, again, I'll refer to another part of the Act. Suppose you take transfer pricing transactions. So to fasten the transfer pricing provision, there's a definition of international transactions and between related persons, and the related persons are defined. So wherever there is an inter say transaction between two independent parties, if there is any common shareholding, and those limits are described by statute. So the statute desires that it should be 10% or it should be 20%, depends on the intent of the legislature and what portion of closely held companies they are defining. So that will form the basis of how they keep control and management common.
Okay, Meeta, you want to add something on this? Okay. Rakesh ji, can you tell me, one want to give gift to his her friend, and that is a car they want to give gift. His car is exempt under section 15.
Yes. Property has been defined under section 56 to 10, read with section 56 to 7. Now, car is not the property, and therefore, it can be gifted without attracting the rigor of section 56 to 7.
I can give a Lamborghini car to you.
Yes, please give. And even if I am made to pay tax, I will pay, don't worry.
okay. So now I have last two questions. Deemed dividend in case of indirect transfer or say round tipping, how the auditor shall verify the same, and also why such transactions should not be considered for tax audit reporting? Anyone, Rakesh? Anyone?
Deemed dividend in case of indirect transfer or say round tripping. How the auditor? So if the assessing officer is vigilant enough, diligent enough, then he finds the round tripping transactions. I am seized with a couple of matters where the assessing officer, by virtue of his diligence, has dug out that round tripping and then has reached this transaction nature of deemed dividend. So it is not, so far as the auditors are concerned, the auditors are not required to report it as per the format under form 3CD. So if the board forms the rule like this or makes the form in this manner where the auditors are required to verify, then they will verify.
Okay. Second last question, RK, if I introduce my share of unlisted company as a capital in partnership firm at less than fair market value, whether section 56 to 10 is applicable, refer 45(3), which is also deeming provision according to which income shall be recorded in books of accounts.
Rajesh, you please read it.
Yes. Now 45(3), now it says that the price at which or the amount at which this capital is introduced in the books of account, that will be deemed to the fair market for the goods or services. But then for 56 to 10, the method of computing the fair market value is as given under rule 11 UA. So if there is a differential under rule 11 UA, that will constitute income in the hands of a partnership firm. There is a dichotomy to this extent under the law itself.
Okay, Rakesh ji, Bombay ITAT gave a judgment that right issue will not require valuation. What is your view?
So I have not read that decisions. Unless I read it, I may not be able to comment it.
Okay. The Meeta has raised this issue to such shareholder.
Pardon?
Meeta has raised one issue in such shareholder, definition of such shareholder.
Yes.
Which is an ambiguity. You want to say anything?
According to me, such shareholder means the shareholder who has been referred earlier. So the shareholder being a person who is the beneficial owner of shares, not being shares entitled to fixed rate or dividend, whether with or without right to participate in the profit, holding not less than 10% of the voting power. So according to me, such refers to such kind of shareholder who has been so exhaustively described in earlier phrase, in earlier wordings of.
Okay, so now before concluding, I just want to give 1 minute to all the four speakers to conclude this. What is their view? What is the message? Because you want to give, Rakesh and Rajkumar wants to give message to regulator. Regulator wants to give message to the industry at a large after listening to various complicated points and confusion. So I will start with Amit, that what message you want to give last 1 minute.
Yeah, we began the discussion with that there are certain anti-abuse provisions that have been incorporated in the Act. They have come on the basis of feedback that is received from stakeholders or through judicial indetermination of income. So it is then that the legislature, and the biggest example is the case of B.C. Srinivas Shetty, which everybody knows, when it cannot be determined, liability cannot be fastened. So therefore, there are amendments that take place to cover complex business transactions. And these provisions have been put in not to put the taxpayer into any kind of difficulty, but for the correct determination of price or income. In doing so, there are certain anomalies and difficulties that do creep in for genuine taxpayers, and I'm not denying this fact that it does happen. And that is why there are times when there are mitigating circulars or amendments like the safe harbor rule for 50C transactions that has been incorporated. Earlier it was 5%, now it has been made 10%. So government does remain sensitive to the concerns of the corporate taxpayers, more so because their transactions are complex, but at the same time, the government is also interested in collecting legitimate taxes from any kind of transactions that may happen. So in that view, it is a going back and forth mechanism, but also from the side of the government, from the side of policymakers, let me assure you that even the process of determining FMV under 11 UA is an iterative process. And if in case the government is aware and sensitive to any issues raised by stakeholders, we can put it up to the government to ease out if there are any difficulties in determination of the correct fair market value. Thank you.
Okay. So Meeta, what do you want to say?
Yeah, okay. Just to conclude, after listening to all the questions and all the panelists, I think particularly these anti-avoidance provisions which all have been included in the statute, they have to be ultimately, you know, they have to be read in the light of the legislative intent for what they were made. So we should not, even the department doesn't want to go beyond a certain intent, because the intent was only to avoid whatever was being, you know, circuited through and, you know, taking advantage of certain loopholes. So even department, for that matter, government also looks into those issues, what was exactly the legislative intent. And when there are genuine hardships, it's always been, the intent of the department that those things should be taken care of, because ultimately we, the entire income tax department and as well as the economy, survives on the actual business deals and business transactions which the corporate world is doing. So I do not think the intent of any provision, any statute, or if for that matter even government, is to, you know, to squeeze the neck of the corporate world and just to, you know, just to create an issue and just to unnecessarily hassle them. That has never been the intent. So in that background, I feel that we have to read every provision for with the basic intent behind it. And that is what is being done. Sometimes it gets misrepresented or misconstrued, or maybe there is a different kind of a decision which comes up at a lower level. So, but we have so many channels where our remedy is there. And I think ultimately when we arrive finally after discussing at various levels, we definitely arrive at a decision which is, I think, favorable to all. So that's my take. And I think for these provisions, it's just the same. Yeah.
Okay. RK.
In fact, we all agree to this, that there are lot of complications involved in the provisions of the Income Tax Act. Therefore, attempt is being made by the government from last so many years to bring a new direct tax code. And when it could not come, then recently a direct tax reforms committee has again been reconstituted. So we should try to simplify the law as much as possible, and it should be business friendly. Litigation should be reduced as much as possible. So there are provisions where the intended objective is not being achieved, and as we discussed regarding 222E itself, then there are certain provisions where there is a dichotomy. Even for the valuation, if you see the valuation method under section 56210 and for the purpose of 56727B, there are different valuation method. So if a person will be caught in either of the two situations, so I mean, this kind of provision has to be made more business friendly, so that we have to look into the practicality. For the purpose of economic growth of the country, the law has to be simple, and the achieving the object of collecting the taxes in the manner in which it is intended to be done. So therefore, in course of time, we feel that these dichotomies and hardships or impracticality which we have discussed would be taken care of.
I would like to just say a word. I agree totally with you, Mr. Rajkumar, that we need to simplify the act. So basically, the issue is that when we are trying to simplify it again, there is a loop. See, the whole purpose becomes like a rat race, you know, so one chasing the other. So when it becomes simple, then again there will be some other loophole, and then again we'll start legislating on it. So I think we have to, you know, that is, you have to take it in the stride sometimes, you know.
The regulator, the legislator, and the other stakeholders have to sit together to evolve a new law.
Exactly. I agree with you.
It was a very indirect tax, all the direct tax support, he was working on this. He was Rakeshji, what is your take on?
My take is that these real income versus the fictional income. A good taxation system, as I have been taught, is one where there is no substantial difference between the real income and the taxable income. But because of the fictions, the taxable income in our country are much higher than the real income, and that poses a lot of problem for the taxpayers. Such kind of fictions which have been created now bring distortions in that theory, and therefore we must try to do away with fictions and then tax a person on the real income basis.
So Rakeshji is mentioning that Lakshman Rekha should be there for real income versus fraction income. Okay, so thank you very much. So on behalf of
How will you tax bitcoins and whatever those currencies are going to come? What about the real income there?
No doubt.
No, in Bitcoin, if somebody has earned income, then he should pay tax.
That's what it's.
Okay.
That is the real income, hardcore real income.
So, on behalf of corporate professional and RRA Tax India, on behalf of Rajkumar ji and Rakesh Gupta ji, I thanks Meeta Singh and Amit Mohan Govil for sparing our valuable time for coming and giving this. And this is a very interesting topic which we have discussed today, and so many issues as clarified by all four learned speakers. And this is a good takeaway for all the participants, those who were there, and 200 plus people are still waiting for this. So friends, I'll just inform you, in continuation to our knowledge expansion to the corporate world, next Friday on 14th August at 4 to 5:30, we are organizing program on insolvency. And Mr. M.S. Sahu, the chairman of insolvency board, is the chief guest who is coming. And the topic is IBC, current development and road ahead for ease of doing business to economic growth. So Mr. Sahu will come, and we have invited PSG Chambers Chairman, President Mr. D.K. Agarwal. So industry view and the regulator view, we will discuss this issue. And after that, we are having a program on, next program is on Friday, 21st August, Consumer Protection Act, and 28th August, valuation. And 4th August, September, we are having a program on producer companies. This information we'll give to all of you, and we try to do something new, some new topic, and we have given answer of all your queries. Few queries which are very big, which we will directly send it to you, or anybody who has sent a query to us but you have not received the answer, please mail it to us. We will ensure that you will get answer from our side. So thank you very much. Thank you, Amit. Thank you, Meeta. Thank you, Rajkumar ji, and thank you, Rakesh ji, for very lively interaction and very nicely presented the entire issues and point of view. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Namaste ki practice hame karni chahiye zyada se zyada. Thank you.